In this video, we're going to look at the diversity of animals, starting with invertebrates. So let's talk about the last kingdom in domain Eukarya, that is kingdom Animalia. The diversity of this group is astounding. With millions of identified species. Most of these are invertebrates. In fact, 97% of identified animals all fall into the invertebrate category, with only 3% making up those organisms that have a skull and a backbone, like humans, cats, and dogs, and elephants, and giraffe. So there are many more types of invertebrate species than vertebrates. When we look at where we are in the tree of life, we see we're at the very end here, this final branch under domain Eukarya. And as we zoom in closer on this tree of life, we see a variety of different types of animals. Just as we did with the plants, we're going to look at the different characteristics that differentiate one group of animals from another. This kingdom, Animalia, can be divided into smaller groups, and we call these smaller groups phyla. This is one of those interesting Latin words in which the plural ends in an A, yet the singular ends in a UM. So in this case, if we're talking about one, it's a phylum, but if we're talking about several, they are phyla. We will discuss some of the more common animal phyla and what distinguishes these groups from each other. So again, the first phylum that we will discuss is phylum Porifera. This is the most ancient animal lineage. And it includes the simplest of all animals. Sponges are made up of a loose collection of cells, and they lack true tissue structure. Now, tissues are groups of similar cells that are combined together to have a specific function or a specific purpose. And that's not really the case for sponges. They have a few different types of cells, but they're just randomly distributed throughout the body of the organism. So, going back to the tree for our animal kingdom, the development of true tissues is what separates the sponges from the rest of the animals. Now the next group we're going to look at is phylum Cnidaria. Now in this case, it's one of those interesting Latin words that starts with a silent C. So it's pronounced Cnidaria. And these include animals with tissues and radial symmetry. It includes things like jellyfish, anemones, and corals. So using a jellyfish as an example, they have nervous tissue, they have muscle-like tissue, they have digestive tissue, they have groups of similar cells organized to perform a specific function. However, one thing that cnidarians don't have are organs. So we have these different types of tissues, and they're arranged in different layers, but they do not have complex structures composed of multiple types of tissues. So that will actually be our next defining characteristic. Sponges lack true tissues. Both sponges and cnidarians lack organs. So the next group of animals that we'll be talking about, they have tissues, they have organs, they are the flatworms, phylum Platyhelminthes. Phylum Platyhelminthes is composed of the flatworms. Now these are the simplest of animals to have organs. And we define an organ as being a structure composed of multiple types of tissues having distinct shapes and defined boundaries. Now although flatworms do have organs, one thing that they're lacking that more complex animals have is something known as a body cavity. A body cavity is a space within the body of an organism that contains many internal organs which are distinct. Are distinct from the body wall. This cavity is formed during the embryonic development of that organism. And there are two ways in which these cavities form. For some animals, the very first opening of the embryo develops into the mouth, and these animals are known as protostomes. In fact, the name protostome, proto, means first, and stome refers to mouth. So in fact, their name literally translates into mouth first. So they're organisms in which the first opening of the embryo develops into the mouth. Phylum Mollusca, phylum Annelida, and phylum Arthropoda all fall into this category. Deuterostomes, on the other hand, are organisms in which the first opening of the embryo develops into the anus. In this case, deutero means second, as in second time or second place, and stome again refers to mouth. So the word deuterostome literally translates into mouth, second. Phylum Echinodermata and phylum Chordata fall into this group, and we as vertebrates are in phylum Chordata. Both protostomes and deuterostomes have body cavities. So when we go back to our group, true tissues is what differentiates sponges from the rest of the animals. Organs separates the cnidarians and the sponges from the rest of the animals. And then body cavities is what separates the flatworms, the cnidarians, and the sponges from the rest of the animals. And with those animals who have body cavities, we have these two groups, the protostomes and the deuterostomes. So we'll start by talking about phylum Mollusca. Phylum Mollusca is represented by soft-bodied animals, but most are protected by a hard shell. This includes things like snails and clams and oysters, but also includes slugs and octopuses and squids as well. In fact, there are three major classes which make up phylum Mollusca. The first of these are the gastropods. These are organisms that have a muscular foot, and they're often protected by a single spiraled shell. Now, in this case, gastro refers to stomach, and pod refers to foot or leg or appendage. And so these guys' names literally translates into stomach foot. The next group of mollusks are the bivalves. These are shellfish which have two valves or shells, and so that's where the name bivalve comes from. These two shells protect the soft inner body mass of these animals. And the last group of mollusks are the cephalopods. In this case, the prefix cephalo means head, whereas pod refers to feet. So these guys are literally the head feet. And if you look at an octopus or a squid, you can see that the body of the animal pretty much does immediately transition from these appendages right to the head, where we would have the eyes and the mouth. And so these are our three groups of mollusks. We have the gastropods, or stomach feet, the bivalves, or two shells, and the cephalopods, or the head feet. The next phylum that we're going to talk about is phylum Annelida. Phylum Annelida includes worms with body segmentation. So these are the segmented worms, earthworms being a great example of them. Just as we saw with the mollusks, there are three groups of annelids. The first of these are the earthworms, or the oligochaetes. Now, in this case, the prefix oligo means few, like there are a couple, there are some, but there aren't a lot. And chaetae is referring to bristles. So oligochaetes, they have a few bristles. The earthworms use these bristles to help hold them in the soil, especially if something is attempting to pull them out. The next group of annelids are found exclusively in the oceans, and these are the polychaetes. In this case, poly means many. So they have many bristles. These polychaetes use their bristles either for moving around or even for catching food. The last group of annelids, which we'll talk about, are the leeches. Most leeches are free-living carnivores that live in a variety of different habitats, but typically rely on the blood of other organisms to survive. The last phylum that we'll talk about in this video is phylum Arthropoda. In this case, arthro means joint or jointed, and pod referring to legs or appendages. So the arthropods are named for their jointed appendages. They have hard outer skeletons known as exoskeletons, and these include crustaceans, arachnids, and insects. So they are segmented animals with specialized segments and appendages. The body of an arthropod is completely covered by an exoskeleton. There are four groups of arthropods that I would like you to be familiar with. Here we see the general body structure of an arthropod, with the lobster being an example. So the four major groups of arthropods, the first are arachnids. These include spiders, mites, and scorpions. This is my wife's least favorite group of animals. Crustaceans are the next group of arthropods, like crabs and lobsters and shrimp and barnacles. Although adult barnacles look a lot like bivalves, in their larval stage, barnacles look almost identical to juvenile shrimp and crabs. And it is actually through observation of that juvenile stage that it was identified where barnacles fit into the diversity of the animal kingdom. The next group of arthropods are the myriapods. Much like the word poly, myria means many or a lot. So these myriapods, they have a lot of legs. These include millipedes and centipedes. And the last of the group of arthropods that we'll talk about are the insects. Insects have six legs and typically have a three-part body made up of a head, a thorax, and an abdomen. In our next video, we'll talk about the deuterostomes, including the echinoderms and also phylum chordata, where we'll find all of the vertebrates.